So before we start, I am viciously close to 100k. And I told myself at the beginning of the year that I would do my absolute best to try and hit it before my birthday at the beginning of July. Obviously, we have just under a month remaining. So if you aren't subscribed and you end up enjoying this video, consider doing so and even leaving a like, as it helps out with the algorithm quite a bit. I greatly appreciate it. So there isn't a single doubt in my mind that whenever Kaizen has another popularity poll regarding its characters, that Maki is going to be within the top 5, at the bare minimum, the top 10. Because the handful of chapters that we've had regarding her growth, the development surrounding her, the dismantling of the Zenon family, her confrontation with her own trauma, her father, the ultimate sacrifice that Mai had to give, the curse that Maki now upholds, which is to destroy everything, is beyond beautiful. This very small amount of chapters is something that I cherish a lot, because I wasn't all too sure on how Maki would move forward as a character to compete on the likes of Yuta, Yuji, Megumi, etc. within the Kullen Games. We knew she was coming back with a purpose, but how would she live up to those expectations, those same powers or beliefs? So seeing this all unravel right before it not only brings her character into a whole new realm of expectations, something that we didn't expect for her to achieve so quickly, let alone so aggressively, filled with so much value. The continued comparison between Toji and herself is one that is consistently brought up. And now it finally has the identity that we've been searching for a very long time. It's going to push itself forward into the Kullen Games and most likely into the finale of the story. Maki has pivoted as being some sort of a side character that was extremely impressive to someone that has stolen the spotlight so effortlessly, yet it all came to fruition at such a massive price. One thing I love about this chapter is how it's actually framed. It's hinged off the perspective of Naoya, and they kickstart it off with his childhood. Even then, seeing him as a young brat, he looks spoiled. He even acts spoiled. The mindset that he has is very egotistical because everything is being handed to him. His future was already quite literally laid out in front of him just because of the exponential abilities and techniques that he upheld at that time. The frame technique and the speed that he has was cherished. And while he is somewhat the most powerful out of Genichi and Ogi, based off everything that we've just seen from Maki, obliterating Ogi in fractions of a second, causing him to react to sheer presence and aura alone, and having this fear ooze out of his body to the point where he would retroactively pull out his own abilities. This is something you don't see all too often within Kaizen. Characters so scared of an aura of an individual that their abilities activate on their own regard, like a self-defense mechanism. We then witness her obliterate both the physical and technique prowess of a litany of different people that the Zenon family specifically train. This is a large quantity of talented people destroyed. They couldn't even touch Maki. Genichi, someone that also seemed rather powerful and kind of the top of the line general, if you will, get obliterated as well. This was effortless from Maki. Her expression did not change. So having Naoya witness all of this fuels back into his ego in thinking that he even has a chance. And while he is exponentially quick, his speed is unrivaled. The power that he has behind that speed is not enough. And this chapter is the perfect depiction of it. All of these chapters, including this one, is a testament to what Maki has become. And this is only the beginning. But this is also a testament to Naoya's character, his backstory, his continued comparison to Toji and Maki, and how much of an offense he actually takes to it. It almost seems like he admires Toji to a proportional degree. Meeting him as a child, he expected this talentedless individual to have a specific type of face, but when he did meet him, he was shocked. He regressed back into that fear, and that is what Toji upholds. This presence that is suffocating. So on his own terms, he's retroactively compared Maki with Toji, but is constantly trying to devalue her based off his own strengths, based off his speed. That if he can take on Maki, that puts him in the same realm as Toji or Gojo even, the strongest of the strong. Of course, his ego flares that misconception, as he is well and truly wrong. And while he does control this fight for 98%, of it, none of it truly matters. The beating that he gives to Maki is surface level at best, and while he does manage to put Maki in a position where she seems fractionally concerned or at least curious on a situation to try and divot into a different fighting style, her expression has not changed. She does not seem desperate or concerned. If anything, she seems bored. This is on top of the injuries that she has acquired, rather vicious ones. So knowing that this isn't even her full potential, this is only the surface of what she's capable of, is scary to even think about. And knowing that we're probably going to see something 10 times, if not 100 times more viral and aggressive within the Cullen Games, when a character that can meet her expectation, her strengths, her value, is going to be such an impressive conflict. But Nalia, for the most case, is the last point of trauma, because he did abuse her. He put this ideal or this belief into her head as a child. Before even going into this chapter, I was solidified on the idea that there would be no way that Nalia would even belittle Maki. And it's most likely the reason why she looks so bored and unbothered towards the whole situation, regardless of how fast or how far she gets flung within the distance. It would be very counterproductive to play upon Maki, to give her all of this growth and development, to allow her to fight her trauma, dismantle her Zenon family, and then the one person that arguably the most egotistical out of them all manages to do something, manages to stunt her or to clash with her on equal footing. It just never made sense to me on why Akatami would do that. I'm very happy that he decided not to do that. Instead, he played within the idea and still made Maki seem more menacing than whatever Nalia was trying to do. He was genuinely going his hardest, going as fast as he could, throwing Maki super far and trying to injure her as best he could, yet nothing would prevail. I also love how Akatami depicts his fighting scenes. He genuinely has an impressive understanding of perspective and or clarity, even though his line work, very playful and rough and purposely aggressive in that sense, gives you such a clear understanding on how massive this fight truly is. Maki getting kicked off within the distance holds a lot of value behind it because of that clarity of perspective. It's so easy to get lost within the combat, within the fighting, within the scenery, but he weaponizes it so well to paint a much bigger picture, to give everything a lot more emphasis, to utilize Nalia's speed. It's probably the biggest reason why he pushed this battlefield in motion, for it to be rather large, so you could capture Nalia's speed in a more comprehensive way. Maki starts to fight back, and you see her take her stance. What I believe is her drilling her feet within the ground to give her a little bit more leverage, and honestly just toying with Nalia. And while his speed still allows him to finesse through the cracks and get the upper hand on Maki, she already sees through it all. Maki is quite literally playing to the ego of Nalia, allowing him to be overconfident in his own abilities and downplaying Maki way too much, which results in his loss. And funny enough, it is probably in the most humbling way possible, as Nalia thinks he has won, has got the upper hand, and is ready to give the finishing blow to Maki. From her blind spot, she turns around and punches him square in the face just once, and he's done, and that's it. Nalia, feeling like he has the upper hand the entire time, playing within his own ego, comparing Maki to Toji and saying that she isn't anything like him, only to be defeated by his own ego, only for him to completely underestimate what Maki truly is, and to get punched once within the face in a way that belittles his speed and his ability. And it brings the chapter to a close. In all honesty, it was really straightforward, super simplistic, but I love the added stuff with Nalia, especially the opening for the chapter regarding his childhood and his encounter with Toji. I am curious, however, on where this leaves Nalia. He's not going to change ever so quickly or just flip regarding his personality, but there may still be some more usage for him. The Zenon family is seemingly dismantled. Anything or everything that was related to it has been quite literally destroyed. Maki has devoured the family with ease. So I am interested to see where Akatami decides to take Nalia. If he continues to be a thorn in Maki's side or someone that conflicts with her, or if he might have a little bit of understanding now, a bit of clarity now that it's been punched into the side of his face. I'm not entirely sure, and only time will tell, but this chapter was absolutely brilliant. So with that being said, that is basically it. I would love to know how you felt about this chapter. Did you expect more from Nalia? Did you like how the chapter itself was framed? Did you think that this was always going to be the outcome? And where do you think this will take Maki? What's in store for her next? I'd definitely love to hear your thoughts. But I want to thank you all for watching. Hope you enjoyed. Drink plenty of water. New video every 3 days, and I will see you within the next one. Goodbye.